the true bridegroom in your grace. Make us and all the faithful departed worthy of your heavenly kingdom, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Amen. is that they may be saved. I can testify that they have zeal for God, but it is not enlightened. For being ignorant of the righteousness that comes from God and seeking to establish their own, they have not submitted to God's righteousness. For Christ is the end of the law, so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down. Or, who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and is so justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Praise be to God always.
To rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Child, what fears they may have about that child,
what could happen to them, or their spouse, or the person who's going to the doctor's office, maybe with a lump, but they're not sure what it is. Some people would rather take the risk of not going at all, rather than addressing their fears and their suspicions, and limiting the possibilities that are there for early treatment. And the same thing is true in the emotional and spiritual life. You know, if we don't address our fears, they overwhelm us and take over our life. You know, I was afraid of dogs. Delivered newspapers for 7 years, I had a very good reason for it. You know, jumping out of the way, getting bit a few times. But somewhere in there, you learn to discern that not all dogs are dangerous. What benefited me was when the neighbors had a little puppy. And you got used to playing with the puppy, and as it grew up, you grew up with it. In a sense, and you realize that they're not all out to get you. I say that because in life that we live, sometimes we begin to develop a mentality that is all or nothing. That if one particular person does something wrong, all of them are bad. As a nation, we deal with prejudice and bigotry and judgment. All people, we universalize all things. And these apostles here, they were terrified because I'm sure they grew up being told, be afraid of the dark, watch out, be scared of ghosts, superstitions. We all have our superstitions. And Jesus steps forward to them. And it's interesting that if Jesus was trying to convince them that he was actually Jesus, the one that they had listened to, isn't it interesting that he didn't decide to use all kinds of miracles to convince them that he was the Jesus that had walked with him? They said, of course I'm Jesus, don't watch me have this a person who can't walk, I'll have him start walking again. But instead, he showed his wounds. That convincing and to truly believe that Jesus is who he really is and all he claims to be, it's not necessarily the miracles. It's what we do with our wounds. When we've been hurt, when we've been pierced, when we've been betrayed, when we have been forgotten, when we have been sentenced. We've all been wounded. Some carrying wounds so deep that it's a secret that they tremble to even consider sharing it with someone. Because their ability to trust is so far gone. Words may have been said that cut so deep that we're afraid of all words, and we shy away. It's very easy to begin to walk a life that's an escape rather than an embrace. He asked them, have you anything here to eat? He's looking for that one part of you and part of me that he can reach into. In one sense, what is left of us after we have been pruned, when we have our dignity all stripped away, or our pride attacked? He knew it then, he could ask them, do you have something to eat? And by that act of surrendering something that they had and giving it to Jesus to eat it and to share it with him, they begin to believe. And yet they still had their doubts. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I wouldn't want this written about me in the Gospels, of all my trembling and fear and disbelief and wandering. But then what good would the Gospel be if it's only for people who have absolutely nothing going wrong in their life, not struggling with anything? That's not who the Gospel is written for. It's written for those who are in need of a doctor, a physician. It's written to the one who has certain fears and superstitions, that are struggling to believe how can all these things in this world continue to happen in the eyes of a loving God when there are so many ways that we fail each other and don't show our love for one another. But it's written for me, and it's written for you, that maybe I have read the scriptures since as far back as I could read. I was one of those families where all of us had a Bible. All of us were expected to read it and know how to find the verses in the Bible. And yet, every day, we have to make a decision to shift the intellectual knowledge into spiritual living. And it's not easy because, unfortunately, it's usually our tests. It's always the wounds that tell us whether or not we're willing to make the sacrifices to move forward. Now, on one hand, he's telling them to go throughout the earth and preach this gospel to all, you know, and we should be spreading the name of Jesus Christ to all the unbelievers in Jesus Christ. But it's equally just important to spread the message to those who already believe, because you look at these apostles, they still didn't understand the scriptures. He still had to open up their minds. There is no time in our life, no matter what age, where our mind is not in need of being opened up a little more, and for some a great deal more, to the meaning of the scriptures. To walk in his ways, to be touched, to let all our wounds lay bare before the Lord. And this is what he does. He sends his healing to us. And sometimes we might not like the way he heals us, because very often it means we have to forgive someone. Sometimes we don't like his system because that means we have to give up something in our life that we don't want to. So we readjust the meaning of the scriptures. We eliminate a certain part saying that's not authentic. We want to eliminate a certain book because it has its challenges. And pretty soon, we're a Bible-quoting heathen, living no differently than somebody who has any knowledge of Jesus Christ himself. The Christian message that Jesus has presented to his closest followers is knowing that sometimes they get scared, sometimes they're terrified, sometimes they're holding on to beliefs that ride over the true beliefs, but he doesn't give up. He asks them, have you anything here to eat? And I ask you to look deep into your heart as I look deep into my heart. In all my sinfulness, and all my failures, and all my imperfections, do I have something to give to Jesus to eat? You know, when God created us, he made us intrinsically good. If we can't find that goodness within us, then we're going to have trouble figuring out what we can give to him. What we can give to him is everything that we are, wounds and all, hurts and pains, disappointments and pride, jealousies and envies, resentment, rejoicing in what's wrong, and exchange it. The liturgy is filled with the exchange. The exchange rate is everything that we are for everything that Jesus Christ is. It's not a fair exchange. It's not an equal exchange. It's the finite for the infinite. It's for humanity for divinity. It's for our brokenness for healing. That is what the scripture is about. Having our minds open up, moving forward. And that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations. Here it says, beginning from Jerusalem, but I'm going to say Waterville, Winslow, Fairfield, Oakland. I'm also going to include Muskegon. You are witnesses of these things.
Father, before all ages.
offerings that your children brought to you out of the love of you in your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and place of their earthly gifts, grant them life in your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to the present, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Mary, Saint Joseph, and Saint Jude. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for Jeanette. Remember also those who share with us today in this offering.
Amen.
If thou have a debt I thee,
give to him a Antara Ulama. will find healing and comfort in the Lord. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for peace throughout the world, especially in the Middle East and Africa, and the Christians who are being persecuted. And an end to war and all acts of violence and hatred. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for an increase in vocations to the priesthood and a consecrated life to serve the Maronite Church. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, strengthen those who call upon the mother of your Son, Jesus Christ, and the saints who have pleased you, especially St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Marin, St. Charbel. Through your grace, make us and our departed worthy of the eternal blessings that you have prepared for your saints. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, forgive the faithful departed, especially Jeanette, who have been redeemed by the death of your only Son. And on that day when all are rescued from death, deliver them from the realm of the dead and raised from the dust of the grave. The grace of your only Son will have been glorified.
and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, the sins of the church. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, the sins of the eternal life. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, the sins of the eternal life.
Receive the holy icon of vocations. May their prayers be heard to bring vocations and religious life. In the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, now and forever.
terrible drought.